James chapter 2. We want to look at how to appropriate things at this matter of baptisms by faith. James chapter 2, verse 17 to 26. Thus also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, is what is dead. Verse 18. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my. What is saying there that faith is not just a word we use. Faith always has works attached to it. The way a man behaves, the way a man conducts himself, tells you whether he has faith or not. For example, a man who does not pray, does he have faith? Because prayer by itself is a manifestation of faith. Praise the name of God. So, if you have faith, we will see it by the way you conduct yourself. That's what he's saying. In verse 19, he says, you believe there is one God, full stop. You do well. But look at what he says. Even the demons believe. And what happens?
They tremble.
The difference between the faith of demons and the faith of a child of God is that the faith of a demon does not save. His matter is ended. His trembling is the fact that he knows the power of God. Every time the Lord Jesus met with a demon possessed man, what was it that the demons would say? They say, what are you doing? What have you? Have you come to trouble us? You son of God. It's not yet our time. Leave us alone. They were trying to be legalistic or the court law. But get out of the man. Come out of this man, my friend. They knew who was talking to them, and so they trembled. So why should you be trembling if indeed you are a child? Why do you allow somebody to be lying to you, or to be cheating you, or to be fooling you, and speaking to you, a believer of ancestral causes? Let me explain something to you. You see, the salvation that you got, many of us don't understand what that salvation is. The salvation that you got is what we call a total package. But like every package, it has compartments. You must open every compartment to benefit from what is in that total package. Do you understand? Now, many of us don't open the package. We say we are saved, we carry the package to better not open. And then we go to church. And one man says, oh, yes, somebody is doing you in your family. How can I ever do you? You are born again. You took the package. Why did you open the package? Because you know, I want to take my time. It's not a matter of taking your time. In fact, in the US, if somebody gives you a birthday gift, in their presence, they tell you, they don't go home. Before they tell you to tell you thank you, you have done this one, you go home, thank you very much. They tell you in your presence. They don't take it home. When we got their birthday, we're one and a half, take it home. Say, no, we don't need you. Be your presence. They tell you. So if you are saved, and the total record has been handed over to you, tear it open. Open it up, begin to look at it. You are given the word of God. Have you read it? Do you believe what is in there? Healing was supplied to you 2,000 years ago. By his stripes, you were healed long ago. Healing, you see, the devil is just trying to see whether you understand what is happening to you. So he brings something quickly, run to drugs. We'll run to this. Believe God. Let your faith show. In verse 20. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect? What is he explaining to us then? In Genesis 15, verse 6. The Bible says Abraham believed God, and was accounted to him for righteousness. So Abraham believed God. He had faith. But that faith was tested. When God now said to Abraham, take your son, your only son, Isaac. In fact, I think he said, your only begotten son, Isaac, and sacrifice him to me on Mount Moriah. Abraham did not think two times. He carried Isaac. Bible tells us in Hebrews that Abraham accounted that if Isaac died, God was able to raise him. So he wasn't praying God. His faith was put to work. But like I said to you, one of the key marks of faith is obedience to the word of God. A man who does not obey God does not exercise faith. Obedience is the exercise of that faith. That is the work of faith. So a faith that does not include obeying the word of God is no faith at all. In verse 23, it says, and the scripture was fulfilled, which is Abraham believed God and was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. In Genesis 15, verse 6, where the Bible says Abraham was accounted to him for righteousness, that was quoting him. Where was that scripture now fulfilled? In Genesis 22. Over 25 years, Isaac came after 25 years, and Isaac was at least a teenager by the time. So, well over 30 years after what God had said, Abraham was now made the confirmation by his works. In the same way, you receive your baptism by faith. Let us see that work of faith in action by living as you should, as someone who has been baptized in the Holy Spirit, baptized into the body of Christ, baptized in water, baptized in suffering. When you have gone through baptism of suffering, you don't cry when they're suffering. In fact, you are warming up to yes, they are moving to the next. When they say the next level, they don't understand. Next level is the next level of suffering. When you have overcome that, you will see the tremendous blessings that accompany those who have overcome. Christianity is for those who have overcome, not those who have underperformed or who don't overcome anything. In verse 1, you see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. Likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? What was Rahab's own story? We know the story is in Joshua. I think Joshua chapter 2 or so. Some spies came to Rahab. So they came to Jericho. Rahab beat them. Why did Rahab hide those spies? In the night, she went to them. She said, we have heard that your God perished Egypt in the Red Sea. We have heard how your God dealt with the two kings that we fear across the Jordan. We have heard those things, and as a matter of fact, the reason why Jericho is shut up is because we are afraid of you. And we know that God has given you this man. He said so. So please remember me when you will come. And he said, this is the promise that we're going to make you. We will remember you, we will free you and your family. But everybody must be in this house when you come. And you must put a scarf, a scarlet scarf, outside your window. Did she do that?
Exactly.
Did she believe?
Yes.
What was that? The work of her faith. Faith must have works. We cannot just say, I believe, and there's no action to prove that you believe. In verse 26, it says, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. The minute your spirit leaves your body, what happens?
You're dead.
So works is like the spirit that inhabits faith, which is the body. That gives faith. It's an enablement. Remove works, your faith is dead. If you don't do anything about what you claim to believe, then you know it's as good as saying you don't believe. Is that understood? Now, let's look at it in application. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. Remember, we read up to 6. I'm going to advise you to read further beyond verse 7. But I'm just going to read two places there. Hebrews 11 verse 7.
By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved out with godly fear.
I think he gave it with reverence.
Prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to. What happened? Noah put his faith to action. The world will end.
God had told him, I'm going to end this world with a flood. But I want you to build for me an ark. Now, looking at the Bible in Genesis, we can tell that Noah began to build the ark around the age of 500, and by the time it was 600, he finished. So the ark was in building for how many years?
100 years.
It is possible for Noah to have gotten to the 99th and said, there is no rain all these years. I stopped the building. Did he stop? He continued to finish. Has God called you to preach the gospel?
Preach the gospel.
Nobody has to say,
preach the gospel.
He didn't say the gospel will be, that people will be necessarily be saved. He just said, go into all the world and preach. He who believes and is baptized shall be. He didn't say automatically they will believe. Your whole job is as best as possible, preach the good news. Do you understand that? That is your assignment. Then anybody who believes, let him be baptized, shall be saved. You can't save anybody. Your preaching doesn't save anybody. But the word that you preach enters into the ears, like we said at the beginning, that word has the power to bring about salvation. As that word is coming, the gift of faith is also given, and that fellow gets saved. Praise the name of the Lord. That was what happened to Noah. Noah received the word of God and with godly fear proceeded to act. He went ahead to build the ark. Even though the building lasted 100 years, he kept building it. In fact, the day Noah entered that ark, he didn't know that it was not returning from that ark. As he finished entering the ark and all his family and everybody, the Bible says God loved him in. And the rain began to fall. Today we are preaching the gospel. And people don't believe the gospel. They don't believe the gospel. As we preach, they don't believe it. We say Jesus is coming, we say, it's been coming for the past 2,000 years. The day he will come, we will know. Those who are prepared will go. The foolish virgins were not prepared. Therefore, they didn't believe. If they had believed, they would have got an extra one. Their faith had no works. And so their faith was dead. Whenever you claim to faith, and we don't see the works, it's dead faith. God did not give us dead faith. He gave us what? Living faith. That is why when God gave you that faith, you got saved. You believed in the saving of your soul. Because the faith he gave you was living. But now that he has given you that free gift of faith, you became born again. Are you still living by faith? Or are you dead? Because if you are not living by faith, then you are living by the flesh. And too many people are living by the flesh. So all the promises that God has made, all the blessings, the benefits that God has given us, that we will receive through baptism, we will receive. What the Holy Spirit will do in our lives, we don't see it. The speaking in tongues, many people don't manifest it. Because they just don't believe it. Verse 24 to 27. This is about Moses. And you will see the faith of Moses. Because there was a man who was raised up in the palace of Pharaoh. Even though his mother still had the initial influence, but she was like the nursemaid employed to raise him. He says, by faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. You know what happened? He refused to carry the wealth that Egypt was going to give him. Why? Because he believed God. He was the person choosing rather to what? Suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Egypt is a figure of sin. Through sin, he was offered the throne of Egypt. He said, no. I would rather suffer with the people of God than the fleeting pleasures of the throne of Egypt. By faith, he chose the baptism of suffering rather than the pleasure that Egypt offered. By faith, Christ denied himself to convert stone into bread, and rather wait for God. By faith, he refused to receive what Satan was offering him. It was a shortcut. It did not include the cross. It did not include the 40 stripes. It did not include the shame, the beating, the spitting. It did not include. He would have been loved by the Pharisees. He would have been lifted up by the world. But he said, no, I prefer the suffering. The problem with many of us is we hate the suffering because our faith is dead. It's time to quicken that faith in you and prefer whatever suffering God is bringing than the fleeting pleasures that sin proposes. In verse 26, it says, esteeming, elevating, lifting high the reproach of Christ to be of greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. Can you imagine that? When you place suffering for Christ on one hand and the treasures of Egypt on the other hand, which one should be higher? Or when let's use the old scale. In the old scale, the heavier one goes down, the lighter one goes up. So which one do you normally think should be heavier? The treasures, right, should be going down. And the suffering should be high. But no, in Moses' scale, the suffering went low. The pressures were thrown up. He gave greater weight to the reproach of Christ than what sin was offering. That sister who is saying that in order to keep her job, she must be with us. She does not esteem the reproach of Christ greater than the treasures in Egypt. If she did, she would tell the boss to stick it somewhere. That will not be. He says, for he looked to the reward. What was the reward he was looking to? Eternal life. Not a momentary pleasure, but eternal life. In verse 27, by faith he forsook Egypt. Look, I need you to understand when I explain the Bible use the word by faith. To appreciate it better, look at faith and look at flesh. By faith, he forsook Egypt. By flesh, what would they have done to Egypt? Would have embraced Egypt. Because Egypt has everything that the flesh wants. But Egypt has nothing that the spirit desires. So by faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king. For he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Brethren, when it comes to suffering for the sake of the gospel, let's esteem it far greater riches than treasures anywhere else in the world. What's that you read song? I'd rather Jesus than the silver or gold, than worldly or fame or something, worldly something of fame. I'd rather have Jesus than any of those things. If you have faith, that's how you live your life. So when the battle of suffering is coming, you will be rejoicing. You know that God is more than able to take care of you. Look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 19. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 19. It says, therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to Him in doing good as to a faithful Creator. When you are being told that there is one, I always tell you, is there one demon? Which demon? Yeah. It doesn't exist. I don't say that demons don't exist, but not in me. And not in my home. Not in my home. It's not possible. It's just not possible. It is this lack of faith that makes many people to begin to see things and say, it is God they saw. It's not God they saw, it's a demon they saw. Because God does not contradict His word.